Okay. Hi, everybody. A very happy new year to everyone. After a long time, we are meeting. I hope everyone is doing great. Right. And a very, 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 very good morning. And a very happy new year. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Only 5 of you are there. Right. Okay. So how are you guys doing? Are you guys doing good?
Thanks, sir. How are you?
Good. I'm good. Right. Okay. How was New Year? Did you guys go somewhere? No, only in home, right? Yeah, in this situation, actually, yeah, it is very difficult to, you know, go out and celebrate, right? Anyways, so yeah, so in your school, which chapter is going on, people? Like, I hope
carbon and its compound, sir.
Carbon and its compound is going on. Okay. All of you are from the same school only? Any other school? Any other chapters going on? Fine then. So we'll start with carbon and its compounds. Right? I think we already started. I think I gave you some insight about the chapter. Anyways, we'll start from the scratch. Right? Okay. Let me share my screen. Okay. This is carbon and its compounds. Okay. Okay. All right. Right. So this is going to be one of the most interesting chapters in 10th for you in chemistry. Right. So this is going to actually form the basis for an entire different branch of chemistry called as organic chemistry. Okay. There's something called as organic chemistry. Right. So there are other departments of chemistry, right? Areas of chemistry called as inorganic chemistry, and you have something called as physical chemistry, right? So these are the three classifications of chemistry. You can study different departments of chemistry, right? Organic, inorganic, and physical, right? So physical chemistry actually talks about physics, like physical chemistry. We talk about the physics used in chemistry, right? So there you'll have numericals and stuff, right? Atoms and stuff like momentum, all these things. How are we going to use in chemistry? That you will study in physical chemistry, right? In organic chemistry, in organic chemistry, right? You are going to study about carbon, right? The entire branch of chemistry is actually given only to one particular element, and that is carbon. And not only carbon and its compounds, as you wrote on here, right? And whatever other than carbon, whatever elements you have, if you want to study about them, that is going to come under inorganic chemistry, right? So when you go to 11th class, right, when you finish 10th and go to 11th class, you will actually study different chemistries, right? Organic, inorganic, and physical, right? So this particular chapter is going to form the basis for you to understand what exactly is what you're going to study in organic chemistry, right? Fine. People. Right. So there are almost 218 elements in the periodic table, right? We have if you have a periodic table chapter also, you will have that, right? So in the periodic table, right, you have almost 118 elements, right? But out of that one element, that is carbon, now in your 10th class, you are studying that, you are given a special chapter, especially, it is especially only for carbon, like as an element. Right? Why is it like this? Right? Why is it that carbon is so special that an entire chapter is dedicated to this particular element? Right? What is so special about this? Right? Okay. Now you have to understand that. Right? You have to understand why is it so special that an entire branch of chemistry, or say an entire chapter, is given only for carbon in your 10th class. Why is it that it's so special? Right? People. Okay. Now I would say carbon is the essence of life. Right. Carbon is the essence of life, right? Wherever life exists, right? Wherever there are living things, wherever life is there, right? There is karma, right? Okay, now how do I prove this to you, right? How is it that life, I mean, wherever living beings are there, wherever there is life, that particular species is made up of karma, right? We as human beings, if at all you take us, right, or any other, from bacteria to a big atom like dinosaur, right, whatever it is, or big life like dinosaur, right, everything is carbon based, right? Everything is based on carbon and its compounds, right? Now, how do I prove this to you, people? Like, for example, right, we have something called as DNA in our body, right? We have something called as RNA in our body. Like, DNA is the one which is actually going to, you know, is the hereditary material, which is going to transfer from you to your offspring, from your mom and dad to you, from you to your kids, something like that, right? So this is a hereditary material. Okay, now if you check what is DNA made up of, DNA is actually going to be made up of carbon, right? It is going to have structures like this, right? It is going to have some kind of structures like this, something like this. Okay, now what am I understanding here? This, okay, don't worry about what am I drawing here. All these are carbon, okay? All the vertex points which I'm drawing are carbons, okay? Now you understand, right? The entire DNA is made up of carbon and some other element, nitrogen, something like that. Right? It is nothing but a carbon framework, right? Okay. So we understand that the DNA is made up of that. Whatever thing you take in a body, right, from a cell, inside the cell, what is going to be there? Everything, and everything literally is going to be a carbon compound, right? Say if you take a cell, you have something called as a cell wall, right? This is nothing but a cell wall, right? Now this cell wall, if you check, this is again made up of carbon compounds. Right, the cell wall, the entire cell is itself is made up of a carbon, like it is made up of carbon compounds, right? Okay, so you understand, right? This statement, whatever I told, carbon is the essence of life, is actually true, right? Everything, wherever you have living things, right, you have carbon in it, right? Okay, now maybe in some other planet, maybe in some other alien species, it might not be carbon, it might be some other element, right? But in Earth, right, wherever now we know, as we know how life it is, right, every living thing is actually made out of carbon, or carbon obviously and its compounds, right? Okay, right, so that is, yeah, so that is the reason why we actually have to study about carbon, because if you want to understand life, right, you have to understand carbon, right? Okay, fine. What are the other special things about carbon? Right? Now, other special thing about carbon, you have to understand that, say, there are, as I told you, there are going to be 118 elements in the periodic table. There are so many elements, right? Totally 180 elements in the periodic table, right? Now, if you compare, say, you take 117 elements and plus carbon, okay? Right. Now, you check the number of compounds formed by all the 117 elements put together. Okay, and you check the number of compounds formed by carbon. Okay, number of elements formed by carbon, you will understand that even if you put all the compounds put together by all the other elements in the periodic table, the number of compounds formed by carbon are huge. It is nowhere near. Okay, even if you take all the elements together and you take all the compounds together of all the 117 elements, the number of compounds formed by all the elements together is still lesser than the number of compounds formed by carbon. Huge, like an enormous number of compounds, right? And carbon can literally form a bond with any element in the periodic table, some element, right? This can be any of the, not 117 elements, 99% of elements in the periodic table can actually form a bond with carbon, right? Now, no other element has this, okay? Some element can form bond only with some other element, right? But carbon is so special that it can actually show friendship. It is actually a friend to all the other elements in the periodic table. It will be able to form a bond with all the other elements in the periodic table, right? Fascinating, isn't it, right? No other element is able to do this, but only carbon is able to do this, right? Okay, right. Now, what are the reasons? Why is it that the entire life is based out of carbon? Or say the number of compounds formed by carbon is there enormously more than all the elements is compounds, right? And carbon can form elements with almost every other element in the periodic table, right? What makes carbon so, like, what makes carbon do all this, right? Okay, people. So we are going to see what makes carbon special. The reason right? The reason for carbon being so special, right? What are the reasons, right? Now, first and foremost reason is that carbon is tetravalent, right? Carbon is tetravalent. Okay, right. What do you mean by tetravalent, people? Can someone tell me what do you mean by tetravalent? Yes, can someone tell me what do you mean by this term tetravalency, or what do you mean by tetravalent? Yes, go on.
Sir, the valency is 4, sir.
Yeah, correct. Tetra means 4. Right? Tetra, this particular term, the half term tetra, means 4, and obviously valence means valency, right? So carbon has a valency of 4, right? Okay, fine. Being tetravalent, how is it again? Why is it that it is so special? Because of being tetravalent? Okay, we'll understand. We'll try to understand, okay? Right. So carbon has an atomic number of 6, and atomic number of carbon is 6. So we know how we write the configuration 2, 4. We write it like this, right? So 2 electrons in the first shell and 4 electrons in the second shell, right? Fine. Now, as any other element in the periodic table, even carbon wants to get octet satisfied, right? So what has to happen for octet satisfied? There can be two possibilities, right? One, I can add 4 electrons to this, right? If I add 4 electrons, it is going to become 2, 8, or I can remove 4 electrons, minus 4 electrons, it is going to become duplet satisfied, 2, right? Okay. Right, so it can either lose 4 electrons or it can add up 4 electrons to either form octet or duplet. Right, but in reality, none of this is going to happen. No, it is not going to happen. Right, why is it like this? It's because we understand that carbon has to lose or accept 4 electrons. Now, 4 electrons getting removed or 4 electrons getting added is really not possible in the reality. Right? Why is it like this? Obviously, right? Because if at all I have to remove electron, right? I have to spend energy. If I have to add electron, then also have to spend some energy in adding the electron, right? So removing 1 or 2 electrons makes sense, right? Why, if at all, for example, sodium, 1 electron you remove, you form Na plus, makes sense. For Mg, you remove 2 electrons to make Mg2 plus, makes sense, right? Same in the case of chlorine, you add 1 electron to form Cl minus, makes sense. But have you ever seen 4 electrons getting added or 4 electrons getting removed? No, you will never see that happening. Okay. So what I have to understand is carbon cannot form ionic compounds. Right? Carbon cannot form ionic compounds. Why? Because only if it can accept or gain electrons, sorry, accept or lose electrons, only then it can form, say, C4 plus or C4 minus. These kind of ions are formed. And obviously, only with the ions are formed, I can have some kind of ionic compounds which can form. Right? So, but I'm telling you that none of these ions are possible. You will never see that carbon is going to be in the form of this ion C4 plus or C4 minus. No, you will never see that kind of thing happening in respect to carbon. Right. So what you have to understand is, since carbon is being tetravalent, removing 4 electrons is difficult, accepting 4 electrons is difficult. So carbon goes only for sharing of electrons. That means what? Carbon only forms covalent bonds. Or it is going to form a compound, that compound is obviously going to be only a covalent compound. All right. Right, so carbon cannot form ionic bonds, it can only for covalent bonds, right? And any carbon for that matter, whatever the carbon you see, right, that carbon needs to have 4 different bonds, because it is going to have sharing of electron, right? 1, 1, 1, 1 electron is going to come from carbon, other electron is going to come from, say, other element, right? Another element will have, say, the purple color electrons, right? Say the other elements are going to form, and which depending on whatever be the element. Right? They will give 1, 1, 1 electron. So that is going to form 4 bonds with each of the carbon. Right? So carbon always forms only covalent bonds. And how many covalent bonds it will form? One carbon atom should have 4 bonds. Because obviously 4 electrons are there. It has to go for 4 bonds. four valence electrons are there, so it has to go for four bonds, right? So this is one very, very, very good reason for making carbon so special, right? Now, obviously, you understand that there are actually other elements like silicon, germanium, which all belongs to the carbon family, okay? I don't know whether you studied periodic table. You'll study periodic table, right? Carbon in the same family, you have silicon, germanium, gallium, and all that, right? These are also having tetravalent, okay? Fine. Carbon is also tetravalent, okay? Now, if other elements are also tetravalent, carbon being tetravalent, how is it special then, right? If at all, tetravalency is the only special character of carbon, there are other elements also which are there in the periodic table, which can actually form a four bonds, like silicon, germanium, like that, right? Okay, then we have to see what other things are special about carbon, right? Now, the second thing which is going to make carbon so special is that it can have a property of something called as catenation. This is a beautiful property. Okay, the second property of carbon, first property of carbon which makes carbon so special is it is going to be tetravalent. Okay, now the second property of carbon which makes carbon so special is the property of catenation possessed by carbon. Okay, now what is this catenation? Right, now catenation is the property of forming long chain of bonds with itself. Right? Read one more time. Right? Catenation is the property of a particular element, right? Property of, say, in this case, carbon, right? And what is the property? It is the property by which you'll be able to form long chain of bond with itself. Means if we talk about carbon, carbon can form a long chain of carbon like this. It can keep on going, right? There is no end to this, right? So this property of forming very long chain of itself, right? Long chain of bonds of itself, this property is what is called as catenation, okay? Right? Carbon like this, it can form a very big chain like this, right? Okay. Fine. You can ask me, is there any other element in the periodic table? Is there any other element which is capable of doing this? Yes, you have elements. Like, for example, sulfur. If you take, again, sulfur can do this. Like this, it can keep on going. Right? Even silicon, to some extent, can have this catenation property. Like this, it can keep on going. Silicon, sulfur, like this, it can keep on going. Right? But the thing is, carbon is the one in the periodic table which have maximum catenation property. What I mean by that, say this sulfur, up to eight sulfurs, it can form bonds, right? Silicon to some extent, say form can go for 10 silicons continuously like this. Okay, maximum 8 or 10 is possible with sulfur and silicon, right? But carbon, really, there is literally no end to this. Right? You can even go for 100, you can go for 1000, right? There is literally no end to this catenation property of carbon, right? Maximum catenation. It can go for a very huge chain of bonds with itself, right? So this is again going to be a very, very, very special property possessed by carbon, right? Okay, long chains of itself. It is not like other elements cannot go for catenation, but their catenation property is limited. Right, but carbon has literally no limit for its catenation property. It can go for any big chunk of molecules it will be able to form. Right? Okay, fine. That is about the second property which makes carbon special. Now, the third and final thing which makes carbon so special, right, is the formation of multiple bonds. Okay, the third thing which makes carbon so special is it can form multiple bonds. What do you mean by multiple bonds? Now look at this. Say, I take an example, okay? Right, fine, no issues. Say we have two carbon atoms, okay? And both of these carbon are going to be tetravalent, right? Okay, for this carbon, four bonds should be satisfied. To this carbon, four bonds should be satisfied, right? Now let me do one thing. Let me make one bond between carbon. Right? Obviously, the other three bonds are going to be there for the two carbons. Like, say, there can be hydrogens. Right? They can be hydrogens. Right? Okay. Now, you see that only one single bond, right? Only one bond is formed between carbon and carbon. This is one possibility, right? Now you can understand that if there are two carbons, right? Now out of the four bonds, two bonds can be between carbon itself. That is also possible, okay? I don't know whether you have seen this before, right? Double bond is also possible between carbon-carbon. Obviously, the other two should be hydrogen, right? Hydrogen, 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 like this, right? There is another possibility where between two carbons, I can even go for a triple bond. Again, all the other one valency should be satisfied by hydrogen. For each of the carbon, four bonds should be satisfied. Please remember that this is the thing which you should never, ever, ever, ever miss. For all the carbon atoms, four bonds should be satisfied irrespective of whatever be the compound it is. Right? Now you understand that in every compound which I have drawn here, right, I have actually made four bonds for carbon. Okay. So this regarding this point, what I can say, what you understand here? Carbon can form single bond. Carbon-carbon can form double bond. Carbon-carbon can actually form a triple bond also. Not only this, it can actually form double bond with some other elements also. Okay, anyways, so this is what you mean by multiple bonds. Carbon is capable of forming single bonds, double bond with itself, sorry, triple bond with itself. Again, no other element is capable of doing this. Right? Either it can form single and double bonds, all the three bonds like double, single, double, triple, must have with maximum efficiency, carbon will be able to form. Right? Some elements are there, right? But not this efficiently they'll be able to do. Right? So, one second, guys, just a moment. So we understood, right? We understand that carbon can form single bond itself, it can form double bond with itself, or it can go for triple bond with itself, right?
So again,
yes, can I tell you?
So can carbon form all the four bonds with the same carbon?
Good question. Good question. So like this, if you want to understand, right, this is not possible. Okay. Not only carbon, any element, right, between two, the same element or between any two elements for that matter, maximum number of bonds possible are three. Okay, more than three it is not possible. Okay, now if you ask me why, right, you really have to wait for you to come to 11th class, right? Now if at all I want to give you some insight about it, right, please understand that these are covalent bonds, right? All these are covalent bonds. Okay, now covalent bonds can be divided into two types. One are what are called as sigma bonds. The other one are what are called as pi bonds. Okay. Sigma bonds and pi bonds. Okay. Now, sigma bond, fine. Don't worry about it, actually. Like, you have to know about orbital. You have to know about other stuff. Don't worry about it. So, what you have to understand is maximum bonds, number of bonds between any two element, not only carbon, between any two element, maximum number of bonds is three. Right? You cannot go for four. And for you to understand this, you have to wait for you to come to 11th class. Okay, because you don't know there are something called as S orbitals, P orbitals. These orbitals will overlap, so on and so forth. You will understand why. Okay. Or if at all you're interested, you can study about it. Right. And then you can ask me a doubt in the next class. Right. You can research about it if you want to learn more. Because if I tell you now, the students will go mad. Right. What is this? What is that talking? It will be like that. Right. But if you're interested, obviously you can go through that and you can ask me a doubt and I'll be able to help you there. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good, good. What a very nice question. Okay. This is a common question. You should have me, everybody should ask this question, right? Why is it that I don't single bond, double bond, triple bond? Why is it that the four bonds are not possible? You should ask that question, right? Everybody can go and check if you're interested. Just a moment. I'll just switch on the power source for my laptop. Right. Okay. So these three are the things which makes carbon very, 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 very special. right? We have seen what are the special things about carbon, and these are the reasons: tetravalency, catenation, and the property of multiple bonds are the three things which make carbon so special. All right. Okay. Next. Now, what and all are the, okay, we'll study about the compounds in a while, right? Before that, we have to understand how carbon exists in nature, on Earth, right? On Earth, in what form? Elemental carbon. We're talking about elemental carbon. That means not in compound form, right? Carbon with other elements, so many compounds are there, obviously, in nature itself, right? But we are talking about a source in which only carbon is present, right? Only carbon is present, no other element is present. That's why we say elemental carbon. So we have to understand what are the sources of elemental carbon, right? How and all carbon exists in nature in its elemental form. Only carbon as carbon, in the form of carbon itself, how does it exist in nature? Okay. Right. Now, carbon exists in nature in three forms, people, right? I would say four forms, but okay, four forms, right? Carbon exists in four different physical forms. Okay, four different physical forms it exists, right? Now, one element only, right? The same element, carbon only, but it is going to be there in four different physical forms. Special again, special property, right? Okay. Now, this property of having different physical forms for the same element, that property is what is called as allotropy. Okay, very important term, right? What is allotropy, people? Allotropy is the phenomenon in which same element, exists in different physical forms. Different physical forms. How it appears in nature? It is going to have different properties, different physical properties, boiling points, melting points, density. All those things are actually going to change for the same element only. Okay, only one element, carbon means carbon only, but it can exist in different varieties of carbon, different forms of carbon. Right now, it is not only carbon which is capable of doing this. We have other elements also which is there in the periodic table. For example, if you take phosphorus, right now, phosphorus can exist in three different forms. One is what is called as black phosphorus. We have something called as red phosphorus, and we have something called as white phosphorus. Right? We have already seen about this. Right? I have already told you about the magic trick. If they just do this, and then the fire comes on the thumb. How? Because I told you here they will keep red phosphorus in the nail, right? They will keep red phosphorus. Sorry, not red phosphorus, white phosphorus. But it is not visible to the audience. Now, the moment they show it to the atmosphere, it will start burning. That is the property of white phosphorus, right? Now, where do you see black and red phosphorus? Black and red phosphorus you see at the tip of the matchbox, not matchbox, matchstick. Right? We know at the matchstick we have that at the end you have some chemical, right? That is nothing but you'll either see two colors, right? One is black or you will see red, right? Now, if you see black, it is black phosphorus. If you see red color, that means it is red phosphorus, right? Phosphorus in general can be easily inflammated. It can easily burn, right? That is the reason why we are using phosphorus in your matchsticks, right? So like this, same phosphorus only, everything is phosphorus only, but the color, the property, the density, boiling points, everything will be varying depending on what is the texture or what is the structure of the molecule. Right, same phosphorus, but different physical properties, different physical forms. So we say that these three, black phosphorus, red phosphorus, white phosphorus, this I will tell that they are allotropes of phosphorus. Right, allotropy is the phenomenon. Right, so what are the different physical forms called as? They are called as allotropes of that particular element. Right, so like that, carbon also has some different allotropes. It can show allotropy. So we are going to study. So these four physical forms, right? These four physical forms of carbon are what are called as allotropes of carbon. Okay. So we are going to study what are the different allotropes of carbon. Allotropes of carbon. Okay. Now we have four different physical forms are possible. One is what is diamond, right? Second one is graphite. right? And third one is what is called as Buckminster, not minister, okay, it is minster, okay, Buckminster fullerenes, right? Or it is also called as C60, okay, fine. And the fourth and the very recent one, right, is what is called as graphenes. Okay, this might or might not be there in your book, right? But this is a very recent discovery. Like I think some 10 years back or 5 years back, only this allotrope of carbon was found out. But this is actually not naturally available. It is man-made, okay? This particular allotrope of carbon is man-made. Okay, this is man-made. Right, but all the, even Buckminster fullerenes to some extent, right? At least the different versions of it are actually man-made. But yeah, it exists in nature also, right? Okay. Now, these are all the different physical forms in which carbon can exist in nature. Like these are what are called as allotropes of carbon, right? Okay. Now, we know how diamond looks, right? Diamond is a precious metal, right? Precious thing which ladies and men, like they wear it in the form of necklaces, in the form of rings, all that, right? Now, diamond, I know, is very, very one of the hardest substance on earth. Right? It is one of the hardest substance. Right. Even if you hit with a hammer, right, we have already studied this in metals and non-metals, right? Right. It is one of the hardest substances. Even if you hit with a hammer, it is not going to break. Right. Now, if at all you want to cut a diamond, right? If you want to cut a diamond, we know, right? Diamond, like you will be able to cut diamond, it's that particular shape. If you want to have it in the ring, you will be able to have that. Right. So if it is going to be such a hard substance, how do you cut that diamond into some that particular shape? Right? What you have to understand is, people, the only diamond can cut diamond, right? Only diamond cuts diamond, right? No other thing will be able to cut diamond, right? If at all, if you want to cut diamond into a particular shape, you can use only diamond for you to cut it, right? No, you cannot cut that with a knife. You're not totally illogical because it's very hard, right? So only diamond can cut diamond. Right, and we know it is going to have a very high shiny appearance, right? Very, very shiny, right? Diamond, okay, and it is very hard and it's very precious also, okay, right? People, right? So, what is it that thing which makes diamond so hard or so precious, or why is it so precious? First of all, now it is precious because what you have to understand is, people, right? Say we have something called as fossils, right? What do you mean by fossils? Okay, now say we know that say thousands or say 2000 years before we had dinosaurs, right? And we had some other animals, right? And we had some other life forms. So many animals were there, they say 2000 years before, right? And they would have died, right? And then when they die, they will actually get decomposed. This is the ground, okay? This is ground, right? And the animals are dead, okay? These are the dead animals. Right. So after some time, right, you will see that there'll be nothing, right? There'll be only the bones. And there'll be only the bones. But these flesh and other things, because the microorganisms, like say bacteria and stuff, will try to act on it, right? And they will start decomposing. We know generally a dead body decomposes, right? So when those decomposes, they will go inside the ground like this. Okay, and as time progresses, say 20 years, 30 years, 500 years, like that, now what is remaining, right, inside the ground is what is called as these fossils. Okay, and these fossils are the one eventually, depending on what is the time period, from this fossil only you will get petrol, you will get diesel, other petroleum products, oil, all these things actually come from the fossils only. Okay, the dead remains, or say the dead remains of animals, inside the earth's crust, right? From there only you will get this petrol, diesel, oil and stuff, right? Now, for this, if it is going to take, for example, say 1,000 years, right? That means what 1,000 years? After the animal is dead, I'm just giving you a random number, okay? This need not be correct, exactly correct, okay? So after the animal is dead, right? After 1,000 years, we'll be able to get this petrol, diesel and oil, right? From the same thing only, you will get the diamond also, okay? Right, from the same thing only you will get diamond. But the thing is, for diamond, you have to wait for 5,000 years. Right, look at this. 100,000 years if you wait, you get petrol, diesel and oil. But if you wait for 5,000 years and then you take it, then you will find diamond. Right. So that is the reason why diamond is so costly. Okay, it is because it is going to take lot of time for diamond to actually get formed. Right, but we know petrol, diesel, what is the cost? We know what is the cost of diamond also. It is because it takes a lot of time for you to, you know, form diamond, right? And mining diamond is also very, very difficult, right? You have to go to very, very deep of the earth, right? And there only you will be able to find diamond, right? So these are the reasons why you understand, you have to understand that diamond is very costly. It is very precious, right? Okay. Now that is one thing, right? Now we understood why diamond is so costly or so precious, right? Now we'll try to understand what makes diamond so hard, right? As I told you, everything in diamond, I mean, all the things which you have seen, diamond, graphite, graphene, buckminster fullerenes, all these are what? Nothing but carbon, right? Now it is all based on how carbon exists, what kind of bonds carbon form in case of all these compounds that makes the carbon hard or soft or stuff. Because we understand that graphite is very soft, right? Same element only, carbon, this is also carbon, but this carbon is very, very hard in form of diamond, but this carbon in the form of graphite is very, very soft, right? And also one more thing, this diamond is a very, very bad conductor of electricity. It's a bad conductor of electricity, but whereas graphite is a good conductor. Graphite is a very good conductor of electricity, right? So same carbon only, but entirely two opposite properties possessed by the allotropes of carbon. Fascinating, right? Right. Now, for us to understand all of these properties, diamond being hard, graphite being soft, diamond being a bad conductor of electricity, whereas graphite being a good conductor of electricity, we have to understand what is the structure which is there inside diamond and graphite. Okay, right. So in diamond, people, right, in diamond, right, now diamond, you understand that it is going to have so many carbon atoms, right? Let me take only four carbon atoms for now. Okay, right. Now we understand that for each of the carbon, four bonds should be satisfied. Right, now say it can form one bond like this, four bonds, right? Say it can form bonds like this also. So for each carbon, how many bonds are over now? two bonds are over. For this carbon, one, two, three bonds are over. Okay, for this carbon also, one, two, three bonds are over, right? Say I could have had another carbon here and say some other carbon. Every carbon together like this is going to have four bonds with itself, and it is going to form a big network of these covalent bonds, right? Each of the carbon, you are seeing only four carbon, but assume that I'm going to have say 2000 carbons, right? 1000 carbon units. All of these carbons are very, very strongly bonded, four bonds for each carbon, right? And all the four bonds are satisfied again by carbon. Because we have only carbon atoms in this, isn't it? There's no other element, right? So each of the carbon atom will have four bonds, right? And what are these four bonds? These four bonds are with other carbon atoms in the same diamond molecule, right? So carbon, like this huge network. It's a 3D network of covalent bonds, right? Diamond is a 3D network, very big, huge network. And everywhere you see carbon, and all the carbons are going to have four bonds, and all the four bonds are again satisfied by carbon itself. Right? So that is the reason why diamond is very, 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 very hard. Okay? Right. And why is it a very bad conductor of electricity? We know for anything to be a conductor of electricity, what are the necessary conditions, people? Right. For anything to be a good conductor of electricity, what is the necessary condition for something to be a conductor of electricity? Can someone tell me?
So electrons should move freely.
Mm-hmm. Electrons should move freely. Yeah, exactly. So we can tell that we should have something called as free charges. Right. What do you mean by free charges? Free means ability to move. Right. So we need to have some charged particle. Okay, we need to have some charged particle, and this charged particle should be able to move, right? Those things are what are called as free charges. Obviously, charges can be of two types. Okay, one is obviously electrons, right? Or it can be in the form of ions, cation, anion. They're also conduct, they're also charges, right? So they're all, ionic compounds are also going to be conductors, Okay, no issues, right? So now it's not about having electrons. Obviously, carbon has four valence electrons, everything is there, but these electrons should be able to move, right? They should be free electrons, right? But in the case of carbon, in the case of diamond, we have so many carbon atoms, but everything, all the four electrons which are there in the valence shell are not able to move because all of them are bonded. They're involved in bond formation, right? So diamond has no free electron. That means what? There are no electrons in a diamond which will be able to move, right? So that is the reason why diamond is a very, very bad conductor of electricity. Okay, right. Now that is all that you have to understand about diamond, right? Now let us look into graphite. Now we'll see what happens in graphite. Okay, now graphite is like a layer. This is like a layered structure. That's a network structure, right? This is like a layered structure. Say this is one layer. We'll just see one layer, okay? One layer of graphite. This is layer. On top of this, another layer. Bottom of this layer. One layer, second layer, third layer, fourth layer. That is how it is going to be, right? Okay. Now, here we are going to have carbon, carbon. Again, everything is carbon only. No issues, right? But what you have to understand is, people, now each of the carbon atom, right, each of the carbon atom will, you will see that you will form only three bonds with each other carbon atoms, right? Again, I repeat, we know carbon is tetravalent. That means it can form four bonds, right? But in graphite, only each of the carbon, any carbon you take, any carbon for that matter you take, right? Any carbon for that matter you take, you will see that each and every carbon will have only three bonds, right? Each and every carbon will have only three bonds. Okay. Obviously, the number of bonds are getting lesser there. All the carbon, in the case of diamond, all the carbon atoms had four bonds, right? But in the case of diamond, all the carbon atoms are having only three bonds in spite of the capability of having, in spite of having the ability to form four bonds. Even though it can form four bonds in graphite, all the carbon atom, only three bonds will be there. Fourth bond will not be there. Okay, so what will happen to the fourth electron? That will stay as such, right? Every carbon will have one extra electron, which is going to be there on the valence shell like this. The dots which I put are nothing but the extra carbon or the extra electron, which is not involved in the bond formation. The fourth electron, which is not involved in the bond formation, right? So we understand that the number of bonds is less, right? There are four bonds in case of diamond. Here I have only three bonds. So obviously, graphite is a little soft because there are only three bonds here. But there in the case of diamond, we had four bonds, right? And second thing is that now, since now you understand that there are these extra electrons which are not involved in bonding, these are my free electrons. That means what? These are the electrons which will be able to move inside the conductor. Since they are not bonded, they are not involved in bond formation, that extra electron is just there just for you to move, right? And if they move, that is why we understand that graphite is a good conductor of electricity, right? The most important point about graphite is that only for each and every carbon which is there in graphite, only three bonds are satisfied. The other electron stays as such, right? And that is why it is soft. And that is the same reason why it is a very, very good conductor of electricity. All right. Okay. So that is what you have to understand about graphite, right? Next thing is about C60, that is Buckminster fullerenes, right? There is nothing much you have to study. You have to understand that there are going to be 60 carbon atoms here, right? There are going to be 60 carbon atoms, and it is going to be in the form of a ball, right? Say it is going to be something like this, say carbon, 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 carbon. There are going to be 60 carbon atoms like this. And it is going to be, eventually it is going to be the form of a ball, right? It's like a football, right? And all the four bonds satisfied, okay? For all the carbons, the tetravalency is satisfied. Don't worry about it, right? There is not much use of it also. At least if I tell you this, you're not able to understand for your level, okay? Right, so that is about Buckminster fullerenes or C60. It is also called as Bucky ball, okay? Because it is going to be in the form of a spear. Right, it looks like a ball with 60 carbon atoms in it. Okay, right. So that is about Buckminster fullerenes. And at last, the recent one is our graphene. Okay. Now, what did I tell you about? Now, it's derived from graphite. I mean, graphene and graphene and graphite looks, the name look little similar, right? So obviously, graphene is derived from graphite, no doubt. Derived from graphite. Okay, right. So what is graphene then? It is nothing but a single layer of graphite. Now, what did I tell you about graphite? Now, we told that graphite, right? We told that graphite is a layered structure, right? What is layered structure? One layer of carbons, second layer of carbon, third layer of carbons, like this. When I just take only one particular layer of carbon, that particular layer of graphite, only one layer I take, that small thin layer I take, that layer is what is called as graphene. Okay, and it has so many, many properties. Okay, so graphene is actually a very good research area, right? It is a superconductor, right? Graphene is a superconductor. What do you mean a superconductor? Literally zero resistance. We know there is a property called the resistance, right? The resistance given to the flow of current, right? So superconductors are the ones which are going to have almost zero resistance. Right, and it is very highly flexible. Highly flexible. Right. So I don't know. You might have seen this in some kind of movies, right? Say this can be used as a fabric. And the research are going on. Okay. Say if at all you put graphene around you, right? You wear it as a cloth, right? What you can do is by just thinking, right? If you just think that okay, I have to call my mom. Right, so the graphene will be circulated, it will attach to your phone, it will call your mom just by thinking about it. Right, so those kind of reasons are going on with graphene. Right, so graphene is very highly flexible, it can be worn into any shape, it can be made into any shape. It is very highly conductive, right? Very highly flexible. So much research is going on nowadays. Right, so you understand, right? Your foldable phones nowadays, the Samsung gave its foldable phones, the same phone that can be folded. Right, that screen, what you are seeing is actually made out of graphene. Right, that the foldable phone, that screen is actually made out of graphene. So flexible. Right, so these are all the things you have to know about graphene. If you're interested, please go and study about graphene. Fascinating uses you will be seeing, like very good research, very interesting research you'll be able to see if you study about graphene. Right, so what is graphene? Graphene is nothing but it is a single layer of graphite. One, the big graphite molecule, one single layer of carbon atoms I take, that is what is called as a graphene. Right, so these are all the different physical forms in which carbon can exist. Four things: diamond, graphite, C60, graphene. That's it. Right, so I think we'll stop with this for today. Right, so you learned so many things about carbon, why carbon is so special, why carbon is the essence of life, what are the different reasons for carbon being so special, and you understood what are the different forms in which carbon can exist. Right, okay, anybody has any questions to ask? Right, okay then, if you don't have any questions, I can end the class. Right, thank you so much people, we'll meet again next week, and I'm ending the class.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.